in solidarity with the Montoya family, with Nico and his parents and his sister, and also people who have gathered here today to figure out, given the leadership of Felipe and Nico and his family, how we can work with the issues there. They've been so clear and strong in raising around immigration and discrimination in this country, how we can build upon that to address what remains such a kind of such a travesty in terms of equality rights in this country. So thank you, first of all, to Felipe and the entire Montoya family for being here. We have a lot to learn from the Montoya family about social media and how to get your issue out there. I'm taking lessons for a 60-year-old association. I wish we could put them on contract.
Well, you'll have to hire my daughter.
Perfect. My name is Michael Bach. I'm with the Canadian Association for Community Living. We're the National Advocacy Association for People with Intellectual Disabilities and Their Families. And we have been around for 60 years and longer than that in many local communities across the country. This is a really critical issue for us. And it's an issue for us right now. Most importantly, I think, and first and foremost, because of the blatant discrimination that Nico is facing in terms of obtaining citizenship status in this country. This is a this is an issue that we've been at for a number of years, and there have been many cases that have come before you. I think a second major concern for us is that this is about an individual and an individual family in this case, but the fact that we have provision in our Immigration and Refugee Protection Act that establishes that people with disabilities can be denied entry on the basis of an assessment that they pose an excessive burden to health and social services in Canada is a barrier that we need to confront as Canadians, that we need to face up to. Not only for the individuals that are denied entry, but because of the message that it sends to Canadians with disabilities and with long-term conditions, that basically you're a cost on society. That's the message when people are denied entry to Canada on the basis of disability. It sends a message to Canadians with disabilities that because of your genetic differences, your cognitive differences, your psychological differences, different states of minds, different physical forms that are different in some way than the presumed norm, that you're a cost, you're a burden. So we need to challenge it, not only for Nico, but for Canadians with disabilities in general. And for me, that takes, there may be, as cases have been in the past, there may be, you know, ministerial permits that are granted to enable people to stay in Canada. And that's often the case, which is also why our systemic discrimination cases become moot when we try to raise the more structural issues at the Supreme Court. Cases become moot because a minister grants a permit. So we have all kinds of ministerial permits that, on the basis of charity, humanitarian concerns, will provide admittance to people with disabilities. And I guess that leads us to our third concern, that this provision of permission that people with disabilities can access Canada, that will, on the basis of charity and humanitarian, for our humanitarian purposes, will allow access, sends a message also to Canadians with disabilities that you're here basically by permission. You're not here as a matter of fundamental citizenship. We'll bear the cost of your differences. We want to challenge that story fundamentally, not only in the media, as Felipe and his family have been doing so effectively, but all the way to the Supreme Court. We're really thankful to Nico and Felipe and the Montoyas, because what we've got a team that we've pulled together with lawyers and different advisors to work on this campaign. And Felipe's been very clear that he doesn't want to just win the battle on this one. He wants to win the war. He wants to bring, finally, Section 38 of the Immigration and Refugee Protection Act into fundamental question and to challenge it absolutely. So we thank you for that leadership and that courage to stand up for this cause. So without further ado, that's why we're here. We're going to go through a few introductory remarks and presentations from a few folks, and then we want to open up the conversation to get your input and ideas about how we can sustain this campaign going forward. We're going to need your energy and support over what could be a long haul. So, without further ado, over to you, Felipe.
Okay.
Thank you for doing this.
Yeah, thank you, Mike. Thank you guys. So maybe a lot of you have already seen this little video that we made. If some of you haven't, it takes 5 minutes. So we'll start off with the video that we created about a month ago, kind of just inspired to tell the story somehow, and then suddenly the story was being told. So my daughter's gonna help me.
We landed in Canada on the evening of Canada Day. It was like an enormous welcome party. My dad started his job as a university professor. My mom was soon teaching flamenco in her own dance studio and putting on shows. My sister, Tania, started high school, and I entered fifth grade. My father said it all seemed too good to be true. The life we had left behind was also a good one, but we were excited to start a new life in Canada. My parents said this country was known for protecting human rights and for welcoming immigrants like us. During the first year, we got used to our life in Toronto, making new friends and getting settled in. My parents even began looking to buy a home. They also began applying for permanent residency, but I'll let my father and mother talk about that.
I had forgotten that the university's immigration and relocation coordinator had cautioned me on the phone while we were still back home that I might face stumbling blocks in applying for permanent residency.
But after going through all the paperwork for the entire family and finally receiving confirmation that our application was complete for evaluation, our 9-year-old son was singled out for further documentation in order to determine our family's admissibility for permanent residency in Canada.
All this because Nico has Down syndrome. Even though he has no history of medical complications, our son was repeatedly required to undergo additional medical examinations based solely on his genetic identity as a person with trisomy 21. The application process that should have taken no more than 13 months dragged on for over 3 years.
During this time, we looked into the laws of this country and discovered the Canadian Charter of Rights and Freedoms. In Section 15 on equal rights, it states that every individual is equal before the law without discrimination based on race, national or ethnic origin, color, religion, sex, age, or mental or physical disability.
This law represented the Canada that we had expected to live in, but the Immigration and Refugee Protection Act, passed by Parliament in 2002, shows a very different face. It identifies 6 categories of people who may be deemed inadmissible to Canada. The first, for security reasons, includes spies against Canadian interests and subversive agents against democracies.
The second, for human and international rights violations, includes people who have engaged in terrorism, genocide, war crimes, or crimes against humanity.
The third and fourth, for criminality and serious criminality, include those convicted outside or inside of Canada of an indictable offense punishable by at least 10 years in prison. The fifth, for organized criminality, includes people involved in international criminal activities such as human trafficking, money laundering, or profiting from crime.
And the sixth, for health reasons, includes people likely to be a danger to public health or safety, as well as people who might reasonably be expected to cause excessive demand on Canada's health or social services. So at the end of a long lineup of people engaged in espionage, subversion, terrorism, human rights abuse, crimes against humanity, war crimes, genocide, human trafficking and money laundering, stands our little boy Nico for having Down syndrome.
But trisomy 21 is not an illness. much less an infectious disease dangerous to public health, nor are people with Down syndrome a danger to public safety. Yet they are singled out by Immigration Canada for inadmissibility, supposedly on health grounds.
I can understand that a country wants to do all it can to keep its people safe and secure, but I ask myself, shouldn't a country like Canada be able to distinguish between the noble act of caring for its people against dangerous criminal activity and infectious diseases, and the shameful act of discriminating against people with disabilities for what they might cost the state?
It would seem that the Canadian Charter of Rights and Freedoms can tell the difference. But where has the Charter been when people with mental or physical disabilities have been systematically singled out as inadmissible to this country?
I guess I'm not the first to be considered inadmissible to Canada for having Down syndrome, but hopefully I will be the last.
All right, so that was the first message that we tried to present. And in the last month, it's been a strong learning curve also to be able to synthesize what the real arguments are. So I have a little PowerPoint here, and I'll try to do it as quickly as possible in 10 minutes. I have like 20 slides, so 30 seconds for each, and give you my summary of how I understand the issue.
What happened?
You know, maybe we should do it without the full screen and just do the little picture.
Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you for your patience.
Or do you have a disc? We could flip it to my computer.
No, just let's put it without the big picture, just like that,
yeah.
And just kind of extend that. There you go. That's good enough. Right. Okay. So, that's the title, Inadmissibility by Discrimination, and then the next one. So these are the two arguments I have, the two grievances against the whole process. And the first one is the Section 38(1)(c) of the Immigration and Refugee Protection Act goes against the Charter of Rights and Freedoms. And it does this by discriminating against people with disabilities. In the video, I had it only about Down syndrome because of my son, but it really is about all types of disabilities. So that's one of my big complaints. And the other one is that the Canada immigration, the whole process uses false, spurious economic arguments, and they're used to hide an underlying stigma that still exists against people with disabilities. And it uses these arguments to justify systematic discrimination. So those are the two things that I'm arguing that occurs. So the first one, to talk about the arguments, the Canadian Charter of Rights and Freedoms, Section 15 says that every individual is equal before the law without discrimination based on mental or physical disability. It doesn't talk about citizens, it talks about people. So some in the talk shows that I've been interviewed for, many people have many arguments that they use to justify, I think, an underlying stigma or an underlying rejection of difference. So some people say, well, the charter doesn't apply to you because you're not a Canadian citizen. But this clearly states that every individual, not every citizen. And the charter does talk about citizens as well. So it does talk about individuals here. Can everyone hear me okay? Yeah? Is it okay? Oh, I can use the mic, okay.
Okay, is this better?
Yeah.
So in contrast with the Charter of Rights and Freedoms, we have the Immigration and Refugee Protection Act, Section 38.1c. So the IRPA is over 40,000 words. And the complaint I have is with these 13 words that are here. Basically, it says that people are can be deemed inadmissible on health grounds because they might reasonably be expected to cause excessive demand on health and social services. So it looks benign enough. It looks like it doesn't look very threatening, that statement. But the interpretation and the application of these 13 words have dire consequences to many people and implications for people with disabilities in the country. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to present different evidence to support these two arguments that I'm making. Oh, before that, well, here are the reasons for inadmissibility. We already saw it in the video. For security reasons, spies and terrorists, criminality, serious criminality, organized crime, international human rights violations, genocide, war crimes, and then people with, supposedly for health reasons. So in the media, and some experts have come out and they've said that the Canadian immigration rules are cold-hearted but fair. And I say that they're not fair. And I'm gonna try to explain why I think they're not fair. So, first I'll talk about the systematic discrimination. So evidence one, before coming to Canada, we were already warned that my son's Down syndrome would be an obstacle for permanent residency. So this reveals that there is a common and long-standing practice of discrimination based on disability. I was warned. So already they know that Down syndrome is an obstacle to permanent residency. I was, of course, appalled, astonished, I couldn't believe it. And everyone I told couldn't believe it, both in Costa Rica. And later when I came to Canada, and I would tell people, no one would believe it. No one believes it, unless you've experienced it in the flesh, you know. So next evidence. All right, for the process of getting permanent residency, we all had to take a medical exam, and that's the normal process. So we all took the exam, and we all came out healthy, fortunately, including Nico. Nico was healthy on all the medical exams that we had to undergo. But because of his visible genetic identity as having Down syndrome, he was singled out for additional examinations, a pediatric exam, spinal columns, x-rays, thyroid exams, developmental and cognitive assessments. So none of us, none of the other people were required to prove ourselves intellectually in the norm, or none of us were examined to see what our IQ was, or to see if we had developmental issues. But Nico was. So some people would say, well, you know, he has Down syndrome, it's logical that he would be examined again. But what I'm saying here is that we all came out healthy. And if there is a clause of inadmissibility because on health grounds, Nico was healthy and the story should have stopped there. But he was discriminated against. He was singled out because he had Down syndrome, because he had a disability. And so I say that that is discriminatory, the process. Evidence number three, okay, because there cannot be inadmissibility on disability grounds, because that would be too obvious and abhorrent to everyone, then I think that people with disabilities are placed under the spurious heading of inadmissibility on health grounds, in spite of being healthy persons, which was the case with Nico. So evidence four. The fairness letter. The fairness letter is the letter we received in which we were deemed inadmissible just 3 weeks ago. So this is the letter that Canada Immigration gives to people who have applied for permanent residency and with their results, right? So in this letter, Nico, they state that Nico has the medical condition of Down syndrome, in parentheses, code 759. I don't know why that bothered me so much, but it's, you know, to have like a seal, like a number, that this disability already is in some list, and they go and they find, oh, code 759, yeah, this guy, inadmissible. So this shows a pre-established red flag for the person with this disability. And it's similar to other forms of discriminatory profiling. So we always hear about other racial profiling, these types of things. And so this is another case of that. Evidence number five, the fairness letter states that Nico is inadmissible for permanent residency due to his, and I quote, moderate intellectual disability. It's not talking about any medical conditions. It's specifically saying he's inadmissible because of this disability. How clearly that contravenes the Article 15 of the Charter of Rights and Freedoms, I mean, it can't be any clearer than that. So those are my arguments that state that the process is discriminatory against people with disabilities. My second argument is that they hide behind economic arguments. And so the first case here is, the first piece of evidence is that if the health argument fails for people with disabilities, as it did with Nico, then the excessive demand clause is used, and the excessive demand on social services argument kicks in. So it becomes an economic discrimination. It's not a health issue. It's an economic discrimination against people with disabilities. Evidence number two. So, and this is, I think this piece is perverse. Excessive demand on social services is the reason for inadmissibility. And social services, there are many social services. I would think that, you know, highways and roads are social services. Policemen, the fire department, schools, education, all those are social services that taxpayers pay into and the state provides. But the social services that are deemed subject to excessive demand are only those services required by people with disabilities. And this is the definition that they give for social services. Social services, they start out nicely, any social service, but then they go on to explain, such as home care, specialized residence and residential services, special education services, social and vocational rehabilitation services, personal support services, and the provision of devices related to those services. In other words, there's a circular reasoning, and there's no exit for people with disabilities. The only services that are subject to excessive demand are those services used by people with disabilities. So, by definition, inadmissible. Evidence number three, and I'm not an economist or a statistician. Nevertheless, in the fairness letter, we're told that the average Canadian per capita health and social service cost is currently $6,387. So that's spread out between all Canadians or residents. That's the average cost. So obviously, if that's the average, many Canadians use more than the average, right? It makes sense. However, the option that they give us is to sign a declaration of ability and intent, meaning that we have the money and we're willing to pay for anything, any service that Nico might require above the average. So the fact that there's many Canadians paying more than the average, but they would require Nico to pay anything above the average, seems to be faulty logic somehow. It's not a very strong argument, but it's there. Evidence number four, Canada Immigration's response to the media. It says, Canada's immigration law does not discriminate against those with illness or disability. It does strive, however, to find the appropriate balance between those wanting to immigrate to Canada and the limited medical resources that are paid for by Canadian taxpayers. Sounds reasonable, right? I mean, every state has to take care of its resources and see where it allocates its money. The only thing is that we, as immigrant workers in this country, are Canadian taxpayers. So, and we have been for 4 years. So of course, we're just as interested as the other guy to where the tax money is going. So the fact that they want to protect Canadian taxpayers, that should include us, but it doesn't. And by us, I mean not this family. I mean all of those people that attempt to become permanent residents and are deemed inadmissible because of some disability. Evidence number five. Again, the response of CIC to the media. Excessive demand decisions are based on the likely costs and the potential impact on waiting lists. The fairness letter cites an appendix and it cites an expert source that explains how the cost is figured out, how they figured out the cost. And the expert cited in the fairness letter as the source for determining the cost. I spoke to her. We had an exchange in email. And I looked at this appendix, and basically it says that the costs are negligible. So the source they're using does not support their argument. Evidence number six, no consideration is made of the possible contributions of individuals with disabilities or their families. They only look at the costs. They don't look at the potential contributions, and of course they contribute, as well as their family members can contribute. So almost to close, we say that the spirit, the interpretation, and the application of Section 38(1)(c) of the Immigration and Refugee Protection Act are discriminatory. Those 13 words seem very benign, but the spirit behind them, the interpretation and the application of them, they are definitely discriminatory. So to conclude, this is not a fight on humanitarian and compassionate grounds, but rather a struggle for justice and human rights, as Michael well put it at the start. So I think we need to oppose the state-sponsored discrimination against people with disabilities. And I want to emphasize that our gripe is with state-sponsored discrimination, because in societies, we know that there's many forms of discrimination. I've heard many people on the radio with you know, racial discrimination, ableism, all types of discrimination. And we understand that not everyone, it's hard to reach everyone, and everyone has a different life experience. But our state, our government, has stated very clearly that in the charter that people will not be discriminated against because of disability. Yet it's happening. And it's happening through state institutions. So we think that this is where we need to put our efforts. Section 381C of the IRPA cannot coexist alongside Article 15 of the Canadian Charter. So this is irreconcilable. This is something that needs to be looked at and decided on. The Canadian people need to decide which they're going to have. You can't have your cake and eat it too, I would say. And of course, we understand that societies evolve and laws change, and we think that this law needs to be tweaked, and that's the normal process. You know, that's how society evolves. The views that we had, 20 years ago about women, for example, you know, men's view of women was different than it is today. When Trudeau has, half of his cabinet women, and they ask him, why did you do that? Well, because it's 2015, right? So I think we have to look at this because it's 2016. And that's a phrase that a friend of mine, gave to me. So I want to say thank you to the 300 plus signers of the change.org petition, to the Rick Mercer rant, I don't know if you guys have seen it, with it's over 900,000 viewers. This has happened in the last week or two. Hundreds of colleagues, friends, and strangers that have joined us in this fight for justice and human rights. I have to thank the mass media for taking this story and taking it all over. And of course, I have to thank all of you, and you've been an incredible support. And I have to thank Nico for inspiring me to do this and not letting me not do this. So yeah, I could not do this. And then I don't know if that has like a little, that's a 2 second thing. It should have done it on its own. Anyway, he plays his little violin and he says thank you.
Thank you so much, Felipe, for sharing the story and also the analysis and the really clear claim and challenge to us to build on this story and to take this issue forward to have systemic change in this country on this issue. We're going to, unfortunately, we're going to move through this so we can have some time to open this up to questions afterwards. Unfortunately, Ameil Joseph from McMaster University is not able to be here, and he was going to set this issue in the context of a critique of, or how this is embedded in a colonial history in Canada, and to bring a critique of anti-racism and anti-colonialism to this issue, which it very clearly needs that analysis, and we need folks in Ottawa reading this issue that way. Unfortunately, he's not going to be able to attend to us because he had a bit of a family emergency. Nothing tragic, but not able to be with us. So it is now my great honor to turn it over to John Ray. John, I'm going to give you my arm as we walk up. Folks, John Ray is a... I'm just putting down the... Yep. I'll take it to the... you want to go up to the podium?
Yes.
Is that easy?
Yes. Okay. Because I have something for you to
know. Okay. John Ray is has been with a variety of disability rights organizations in Canada. Yep, up here. Has been a... national, if you want to just step behind them, a national leader with the Council of Canadians with Disabilities, which is the cross-disability organization bringing consumer organizations together across the country, has been a passionate and articulate voice for human rights, equality, citizenship of Canadians with Disabilities. And last weekend was on panels talking on assisted suicide, here tonight, next week at, I think, Committee of Justice, talking on the reinstatement of the Court Challenges Program. So he's a great voice for our movement and for Canadians. John, over to you.
Thank you. These gentlemen are hard acts to follow, folks. But I want to thank publicly, Madeline Spangler, for inviting me to join this panel and to give me the opportunity to stand in solidarity with the Montoya family. We in the Council of Disabilities, Council Canadians of Disabilities, we are a national cross-disability organization working for a more accessible and inclusive Canada. Part of our work has involved lobbying for legislation, and believe me, a lot of the legislation that we now have was not given to us on a silver platter. Michael knows this very well. We have had to organize, lobby, and sometimes fight awfully hard. It's been worth it. We're also involved, of course, in public education, in policy development, and occasionally we even intervene in court cases as high as the Supreme Court. The issue of immigration, for me, I was born here in Toronto. You would wonder, why has this been of particular interest to me? It is. I've been involved in this issue for longer than I care to remember. And it seems to me it's one of those topics that we can describe as the more things change, the more they stay the same. And it's about bloody time that stopped. Michael talked about what this clause in the Immigration Act says to we who are disabled. Michael, you're right, but I suggest it says even more than that. It says to the broader community, those who are not disabled, things I really don't want to hear. That we are burdensome, that we are expensive, and that we're a problem. And that we're not healthy. Well, I reject all that stuff. Reject all of it. Yes, I do get sick once in a while, but I reject any notion that assumes I'm sick all the time. I'm not. I have a disability. That's part of who I am. So, let's unpack Section 38 even a little bit more, because while it has been described in graphic terms about how discriminatory it is, and it is, I suggest we ought to unpack the language a bit more, and I'm afraid it's even a bit more insidious than it's been described. Hard though that is for you to imagine, right? So, it focuses on health. And again, that sends a message to immigration officers and to prospective immigrants that if you have a disability, you're sick. Well, some of us get sick. Yeah, we do. So do you. But as I say, I reject the notion that we are inherently sick. The section speaks about reasonably. What is reasonable? That implies to me that an individual assessment has been made of each applicant. We at CCD get contacted several times every year by people who are having the same problem the Montoya family now face. You know, inadmissibility. Some members of a family are okay, their disabled son or daughter is not. Well, based on what we just heard from Mr. Montoya, I suggest that a lot of times the examination isn't very individual, and that the decisions that are made by immigration officers abroad are not very individual, and they are based on superstition, on assumptions, and on negative stereotypes. The same kind of negative stereotypes that we deal with here in Canada all the time. So, when we look at our current situation, there's a very juxtaposition. We have coverage under every human rights code and tribunal at the federal, provincial, and territory level across Canada. We gain charter rights, the first states parties to include disability in its federal constitution. And more recently than any of those, Canada is a signatory to the UN Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities. That's the good news. The bad news, of course, we've still got Section 38 to contend with. So, what ought we do? In the federal budget, recent federal budget, the government has committed to reinstating the Court Challenges Program. And I think that's going to happen soon. In fact, my colleague Ann Levesque, who's chair of CCD's Human Rights Committee, and myself are appearing before the Justice Committee a week from Tuesday to talk about how we think a new program ought to look. So I think we may have it sooner than later. And of course, when it was there, it provided funding to challenge government decisions. These are government decisions. These exclusions are government decisions. But at the same time, we also have in the federal budget $2 million earmarked for the federal government to consult on a National Disability Act. It's gone under several titles. We used to think of it as a Canadians with Disabilities Act. When my colleagues met with Minister Poitras recently, she's calling it a National Accessibility Act. I'm not sure what the difference is, but we'll see. The important point, though, is I believe Canadians will have the opportunity to have a significant input into what that act might look like. Well, if we're going to have an omnibus act, if we're going to have an act that's going to accomplish anything, it's got to have meaningful changes in it. I suggest that working on this is one of the meaningful changes it ought to contain. And so there is room for all of us. Whether we develop a new case to take before the courts, which is a long struggle, or whether we attempt to use the political route by trying to get the act changed through the possible National Disabilities Act, I think the future may look a little brighter than the past. And believe me, I'm not the most optimistic guy around. I've been doing this stuff for 41 years, my friends, and sometimes we win. Good when we win. We don't win often enough. With the new government, with the commitments it has made, and with the signs that we have seen already, even I'm starting to feel a bit more optimistic, and that's saying a lot, guys. But what I'm saying is we got to strike while the opportunity is here. And whether it's through the courts or through the political route, there is room for all of us to be involved. This is the time to make sure our elected officials make good on some of the promises that we got during election time and make significant changes in the lives of people with disabilities. It's our time. It's about time, don't you think? Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, John, for sharing that history with us. And you want to sit in these chairs right here?
We're
okay. There's a chair right here.
Let's go. Yeah. Yep. Yep. Good. Got it. Yep.
There's a mic. Good. Okay. I outlined, I think, in my introductory remarks, the concerns from the perspective of our association. First, to support a family that's stepping up to challenge the systemic discrimination in the Immigration and Refugee Protection Act. Second, to bring forward the kinds of issues that John has been framing for us, and that Felipe did earlier, and that is that the very presence of this provision sends a message that Canadians with disabilities are perceived first and foremost as a cost to Canadian society. So, and a burden, and we need to challenge that. So one of the questions is, how do we go about challenging that? And that takes us, I guess, to our third concern, which has happened with cases in the past, where a case will get so far, and then, what's that, John?
Lots of them.
And then there will be a ministerial permit that says, right, okay, on the basis of humanitarian grounds, we'll grant residency and access, and then on that basis, the larger systemic case becomes moot. So how do we use the offer, it moot in the legal sense that we can't take the case forward to the Supreme Court of Canada because the issue, there's no more issue, this person's here. So how do we use this moment not only to win the battle, but win the war, as Felipe has said, so that we can get the systemic issues raised. So just to sort of bring you up to sort of share with you a couple of the things that we're doing, and then I'd like to turn it over to Hadayt Nazami, who as a human rights lawyer, is gonna share some reflections on how we launch strategic litigation to build on this case. So as John said, we're going to use the, I think it's quite helpful, in fact, that Minister Qualtro has reframed this exercise to make it a National Accessibility Act, because this is an issue of access, right? Yep. So we're going to push this as a major issue of access in Canadian society, and we're going to push, as John said, an omnibus approach, that we're not just looking for access to federal buildings for people using wheelchairs. We want to talk about access to Canadian society, not only to our built environment, but to the social environment and to full citizenship in this country. We're also, as John has said, Canada has signed and ratified the UN Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities. And Article 18 of the Convention says very clearly, and it's the article on freedom of liberty and movement, that you cannot discriminate in immigration on the basis of disability. Canada's report is now going to be up before the UN treaty body monitoring the report, and we're, as a disability community, preparing what's called the shadow report to respond to the government's report on how brilliantly, and it was the previous government who wrote the report, how brilliantly they're doing on in terms of the rights of persons with disabilities. We're going to provide a fairly sobering report, and when we meet with the committee in August in Geneva, we'll be using this case as an example of exclusion. Okay, thank you. So I guess the third question then, or another step in our strategy, is how to move towards strategic litigation. And I'm going to turn it over to Hadayt, but just to say, about 10 years ago we had a similar case, the Hilowitz case, and we intervened in the case all the way up to the Supreme Court. And again, by the time we got there, the case, we couldn't introduce it as a charter rights and equality rights case. All we could do in that case was challenge the notion that you could take a diagnosis, like a code 759, and attach, by definition, an assessment that Down syndrome, by definition, was imposed an excessive burden, or any other disability label, by definition, imposed a burden. So the most that we got in that decision from the Supreme Court, it was a step along the way, was that an individualized assessment needed to be done. You couldn't say, okay, you have Down syndrome, therefore, ergo, you're an excessive burden in Canadian society. But that leaves the bigger question unresolved. So it's great that Nico gets an individualized assessment. Right. He's still got an individualized assessment, but at the end of the day, it's still deemed to be a burden. So, and the individualized assessments are to take in the community support and the family resources, financial and otherwise. But that still leaves people with disabilities in this country and who want to immigrate to this country as second-class citizens. So we're now at a stage where we want to see how we can move forward litigation to address these systemic issues, and I'm going to turn it over now to Hadayt.